Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lady Henterman's Wardrobe, a Streets of Maradaine novel by Marshall Ryan Maresca, narrated by Dan Calley. Chapter 1. There was nothing a thief liked more than a boring, predictable person, especially when that person was in charge of the security for the place he wanted to break into. Asti Rynax had spent 10 days trailing a man named Nell Pitter, and several more before, studying him. In those days, he had learned absolutely everything there was to know about the man, which was very little indeed. Pitter worked nights, so he slept during the day. His apartment was a second-floor flat in a whitestone in the tiny southern end of Promenade in Einmar, which he shared with 3 other men. All 4 men in that apartment worked as security guards for the Pomeraine building in different shifts. Most of the residents of that whitestone worked at the Pomeraine. Asti imagined housing was part of the wage, as there was no way a security guard would otherwise be able to afford such an apartment, even shared with 3 others. The Pomeraine took care of its employees. The Pomeraine was a 7-story office building, the absolute pinnacle of modern architectural grandeur on the south side of the city. It towered over its namesake street, just 1 block east of Lowbridge. Perfectly situated where the money of East Maradaine met the commerce of Einmar. It housed offices for trading houses, speculators and merchant moguls. And most importantly, the legal offices of Colvar and Associates. All of the men who lived in that apartment, including Pitter, were incredibly regular in their schedules. Asti had watched all of them, learning their habits. He had determined there was no viable moment of opportunity where he could count on the apartment being unoccupied or everyone inside being asleep. Breaking into the apartment wasn't an option, but Asti had already dismissed that, since Pitter's usual activities made him an excellent mark for a different kind of run. He had explained it to the rest of the crew before they had prepared for the play. Pitter sleeps during the day and wakes up at 5 bells in the afternoon each day. Helen can confirm. Helen Kesser had scouted him through her scope from the opposite roof. Literally, the bells of St. Olica wake him up, not the 3 or the 4, just the 5, Helen had said. It's creepy. Wakes up at 5, hits the water closet, gets dressed, always with pressed shirt and polished boots, presses and polishes himself every day. Asti had seen Pitter come out each day, right at 6 bells, looking as crisp as the vegetables in his sister-in-law's garden. He would stride down to Low Bridge Street, arriving at the Gentle Shepherd for dinner, or breakfast in Pitter's case. His meal was always the same, half a roast chicken dressed with pickled onions, cabbage soup, soft cheese and mustard, and a soft cider. Each night the same? Asti's brother Verci had asked. You sure of that? Not that the menu at the Gentle Shepherd offers much option, Asti said, but that's his place, no change, which makes him perfect. Asti sat in the back corner of the Gentle Shepherd at 6 bells, slowly nursing his own soft cider. Not what he'd normally choose, but tonight was a run, so it was best to stay sharp. The rest of the crew were in position. The only one he could see right now was Helen, dressed like a laundry girl. She had been disguised with Pilsen Gin's ministrations, so her rich brunette locks were hidden under a mousy brown wig and grey kerchief. No one from the North Seleth neighbourhood would recognise her. She even wore a set of spectacles, fake lenses, and sat at another table with her nose in a book. That was the other thing their observation of Pitter had yielded. The man was a reader. His evening meal was taken while reading. When he wasn't walking his patrol of the Pomeraine, he was reading. He read while eating his other meal at sunrise, and for another hour before going to sleep at exactly 9 bells in the morning. Helen was reading, or pretending to read, The Shores of New Fenkel, the war novel that Pitter had been working on in the past 2 days of observation. She had balked at the idea of actually reading it herself. Had enough of schooling when I ditched school. You don't curl up with penny hearts every night in your bed. You need to not be thinking about my bed and what happens there, Asti Rynax. So Asti had read it that morning and briefed her on it, or at least the 5 chapters. Enough so she could fake her way. It was a serviceable enough adventure book, set during the early days of the Island War, though it was based on fantastical ideas about a squadron of Druth soldiers holding against an entire Poasian company. Under normal circumstances, Asti would probably enjoy reading it, but this was a job. They had had to get to Pitta. Pitta would get them the Pomeraine. The Pomeraine would get them Colvar and Associates. Colvar and Associates would get them the client who had paid to burn down Holver Alley so they could force out the residents and buy up the land. Pitta came in, right on time, his book tucked under his arm. He sat down at the same table he always sat at, right in Asti's line of sight and right where Helen could move in on him. He gave a signal to the proprietor, who knew him well enough to simply nod back in reply. In a moment, Pitta's cider was delivered, and he was deep into his own copy of The Shores of New Fenkel. Alma Court came in a few steps behind Pitta, taking a place at a far table. His job was simple, at least this part. He had to follow Pitta from his apartment to the gentle shepherd and give signal if anything was wrong. Court ordered wine and bread, which meant everything was going fine. That gave Helen her cue. She reached from her seat over to Pitta's table. "I'm sorry," she said, talking through her nose. It was slightly painful to Asti's ears. Pilsen hadn't given her much instruction on accents or voices, and she insisted on using one for this job. It was not in her skill set.
"I couldn't help but notice."
She held up her book to him.
"Oh, yes," Pitta said. "How far are you?"
"Chapter 5," she said. "You?"
9, he said. He was a bit standoffish, like he wanted to get back to his reading.
Helen wasn't going to quite let that happen. She moved herself, book and cider, to his table and sat down.
"I'm just loving it so far," she said,
putting one hand on his arm.
"I mean, it's the first one of this author that I've read, but it's thrilling."
Pitta put his book down and locked eyes with Helen, which of course he would. Even in the dowdy disguise, she was a good-looking woman, and she had already shown a mutual interest. Now she just had to keep him.
"I've been following this writer for a bit now," Pitta said. "He started out doing serials in, do you read the sword pulps?"
"No," Helen said, "but I want to know about them."
She scratched her ear to cue the next step. Mila was in place for that, watching through the window of the gentle shepherd from the street. Mila Kendish wasn't in disguise, other than wearing a similar laundry girl outfit. She came into the shepherd and went straight for Helen and Pitta.
"Cassie,"
she said to Helen. That was a name they chose when they worked out this bit.
"What are you doing? You were supposed to come home an hour ago."
"I'm having a perfectly lovely conversation with a fellow imaginative soul," Helen said.
"This Steve?"
Mila said, prodding at Pitta.
"Who are you?" Pitta asked.
"She's my baby sister," Helen said, "and she's annoying."
"You shouldn't..."
Mila started, her hands giving a signal to Asti and Helen. She had Pitta's keys.
"Go home yourself, Sarah," Helen said. "I'll get there when I get there." "Jerry won't."
"Not your problem."
"Fine."
Mila rolled her eyes and stomped off. Perfect performance.
"But I ain't gonna lie for you."
She went out.
"Ignore her,"
Helen said.
"Tell me more about this writer's other work."
Pitta launched into a description while his meal arrived. That and Helen should keep him suitably distracted while Mila ran the keys to Verci and Wynne Greenfield, sequestered in a back alley flop a block away. Wynne could make an imprint of the keys in a matter of minutes. That was all the easy part. Helen kept up her end of the conversation while Pitta went on, eating and drinking the whole while. She was engaging, and he was engaged. As she had to admit, he was pretty impressed with her hair. He'd always known her to be a crack shot with a crossbow. 3 months ago, that's all anyone thought of her, and no one wanted to bring her in on a job. Her attitude had given her and her cousin a bad reputation, and several folks on the street couldn't stand working with her. But Asti had known her since he had been out of swaddling, and knew she could be better, do more. She just needed a reason. Getting the folks who burned down the alley, killed her grandmother, that had given her a damn good reason. Mila was in the window, nodding. Now she just had to get the keys back in his pocket. Time for the big move. Asti gave a nod to Alma, who loudly ordered a cider from the barman. That let Helen know what was coming. She signalled to the barman for another round of cider herself. Mila came running in,
faking she was out of breath.
I told you,
she heaved.
I told you he wouldn't...
Shove off, Helen said, getting up.
Jerry asked where you were, and I said I wouldn't lie for you.
You told him.
I told you.
Cassie.
A giant brute of a man came into the gentle shepherd. Jerry, or rather Helen's cousin Julian, also disguised by Pilson.
Why can't you let me be?
Helen cried as Julian stormed over.
What do you think you're doing?
Julian slammed a massive fist on the table, rattling the plates and knocking over the ciders.
Who is he? Pitter asked.
Her husband, Mila said, cowering near Pitter. Blazes of a temper.
Husband? And who are you?
Julian snarled at Pitter. Pitter held up his hands, open wide.
Hey, she just came over to talk about the book. I just talked about books.
Helen got on her feet, moving in close to Pitter.
He likes books. He's interested in those things, unlike some people.
Mila had clutched onto Pitter.
The last time she did this?
Last time? Pitter asked. You make a habit of this, you slan.
Helen gasped and then slapped him. That was off script. A bit worrisome, but Mila had already gotten his keys back into his pocket. That girl had incredible hands. She could steal a feather from a bird mid-flight.
Well then, Pitter said. He turned to Julian. Sir, I'm sorry for any inappropriate appearance. I had no untoward intention to your wife and wish no quarrel with you.
Cassie,
Julian grunted.
Get on.
Helen stormed out of the gentle shepherd, inventing new invectives and curses as she left. Mila followed after her.
Enjoy your dinner,
Julian said, and stalked off. Pitter huffed in discontent and sat back down. Taking a moment to situate himself back to his meal, he started again eating and reading, drinking the cider he had presumed the barman brought when the old one had spilled. He hadn't noticed Alma was the one who had delivered the new mug.
They won't taste any different, Alma had said. The stuff I'm slipping in pretty much tastes like cider anyway. The only difference is, an hour after he drinks it, he won't be able to get out of the water closet.
Asti had been on the receiving end of a few of Alma's apothecarial nightmares, and he didn't doubt that Pitter would be in for a horrible night. With Pitter out of commission and copies of his keys, they were all set to get into the offices of Colvar and Associates. After a month of planning, tonight was the night. Verci Rynax's fingers twitched while he watched Wynne Greenfield work. He wasn't quite sure what Wynne was doing, but he understood just enough to be frustrated. He knew making things and taking them apart, and that included how locks worked. In his prime, he could jimmy or jam most locks in a few minutes, or find some way around them. But he didn't know locks and keys like Wynne did. The man had them in his very heart. And with the death of his wife and daughters in the Holver Alley fire, it was pretty much the only thing Wynne had in his heart. So Wynne worked in silence while Verci watched over his shoulder, trying in vain to figure out exactly what Wynne's intentions were. It also didn't help that Wynne's hands were shaking and his whole head was covered in nervous sweat.
Is your plan to cut copies of the guard's keys?
Verci asked after watching in a complete loss. Wynne didn't seem to have cutting tools at all. He had rings and rings of keys and the soft clay prints he had made of Mr. Pitter's keys in the brief moments Mila had allowed them to do it. Wynne looked like he was completely out of sorts, grabbing keys, looking at them, slamming them down on the table. Wynne didn't speak, save muttering a few curses under his breath. Verci wasn't able to help Wynne, and he was just going to have to deal with that and wait. This was the annoying thing about the way Asti liked to work. Asti loved milking out the watching, stalking and planning, being downright languorous in figuring out how to pull a job. But then when it came to do the job, then everything was in a rush, having to move like perfect gears. And when the gears didn't mesh quite right, it always seemed to be up to Verci to be the lubricant to make it all work. Tonight was no exception. Asti had come up with a glorious gambit. Verci admitted Asti could be proud of the plan, to copy a guard's keys to the Pomeran building and put that guard out of commission for the night. An excellent way to give them a window to break in, dig through their files, and find out exactly what they knew about who hired Mendel Tyne to burn down the alley. Except Asti's plan meant it all had to happen in one night, and they'd only have the keys in hand for a few moments. Wynne was confident he could do what Asti needed, but Wynne wasn't like Asti or Verci or the rest of the crew. At his centre, Wynne was an honest tradesman. He used to work keys and locks legitimately, shop with a sign out front. He didn't think in terms of the gig night. He thought about making copies of keys with all his tools at a proper workbench, like the one they had at the safe house. The safe house was back in North Seleth. Here, where Einmar butted up against East Maradaine, they only had a back room flop over a pub called the Thundering. A pub with a stupid name, Verci thought, but it was the easiest place they could find a room to work in that Mila could run to from the Gentle Shepherd and back again in a matter of minutes. In the room over the Thundering, Wynne only had the equipment he could easily bring in with him without raising too many eyebrows from the proprietress. Two men holed up in a back room with a young girl occasionally running in and out already raised that woman's eyebrows quite a bit.
"I can't cut new keys here, of course," Wynne said, "but you don't want a perfect key."
"I think I would," Verci said. "That would be rather useful."
"Useful for getting into the places that a guard is allowed," Wynne said.
He looked at the imprints he made again and pushed two away. "What's wrong with those?" Verci asked.
"Those two have nothing to do with the Pomeran. One is for his apartment and the other, some other personal need, maybe a basement or building key for the apartment building. Point is, they're a totally different style, less complicated. These are the Pomeran locks."
He indicated the three imprints in front of him. "More complicated?" Verci asked. That didn't sound good.
"Gloriously so, but in similar ways, which is part of the challenge here."
He pointed to two of them.
"These are the important ones, at least for Mr. Pitter's job. They showed more wear when I saw them. But also there are only some minute variations to their cuts."
"What does that mean?"
"Ah," Wynne said. "It means, well, this is what I think at least, each of these keys probably only opens one lock, and they won't open each other's locks."
"Yes, I understand the basic principles behind keys, Wynne," Verci said.
"But the way they are designed, the similarities, makes me think there is a key that would open both locks, and maybe many others in the building."
"A master key?"
"A master key," Wynne repeated. "Now, the question is, which of my dummy keys can I file down to match them? And knowing what I know about these keys, can I make a master key for you to use, especially one that would get you..."
"Into rooms Pitter isn't allowed to," Verci finished, seeing where Wynne was going with it.
"So where are we at?" Asti had come into the flop.
"Working on it," Wynne said.
He selected one of his dummy keys and started filing.
"Going to be a bit."
"A bit is fine," Asti said. "We're all white flags so far."
"So Mila did the slip back?"
"Clean as a fresh shave, and Pitter drank the concoction. I watched until he took down every drop and went off to work.
So what's our window?"
"Alma says he'll be stuck in the water closet for the night, starting in about an hour. The question is how much pride he has."
"What does that have to do with it?" Wynne asked.
Verci understood. "The prouder he is, the longer it'll take him to admit that he's sick and needs someone to cover his watch. So the gap in the watch stands until he gives in. What's your gauge of that, brother?" Asti screwed his face in thought. "I think it'll take him at least an hour, maybe an hour and a half." "That leaves us less time than I'd like."
"Anything short of all night is less time than you'd like."
"Yes," Verci said. "I would love the whole night without a single guard in the whole building. That won't happen. Even with Pitter making a hole, there'll still be at least four on duty, presuming we don't miss something in our watch."
"I don't think I did. Did you, brother?"
Verci knew Asti was just ribbing him. He didn't really think he had been negligent in his scout, but he was trying to get Verci to agree to the plan he had originally had, the one Verci didn't want to do. "You're still thinking we're going to have to top and bottom this, aren't we?" Verci asked.
"I told you that 10 days ago," Asti said, "and every day since then."
"I didn't like it on any of those days, and I don't like it now," Verci said. "But you're right, time's too short, and we don't know what we're looking for."
"What does this mean?" Wynne asked.
Asti sighed.
"A top and bottom." "I understand that, Asti," Wynne snapped. "Someone goes in ground level, someone goes in on the roof. Really, the little codes between the two of you are not anywhere near as clever or impenetrable as you seem to think."
Asti looked abashed. "Didn't want to presume."
"I meant," Wynne continued, "what does this mean you'll need from me? The plan involved me making a key set for Verci to take in from ground floor. Has that changed?"
Asti chuckled nervously. "Yeah, Wynne, that's changed. Versi's going in from the top, and I'm going in from the bottom. Problem is, I'm not much of a locksmith.
Chapter 2. Asti admitted, bringing Wynn along on the run in the Culver offices was less than ideal. Wynn was great with his hands, one of the best lockmen he had ever seen. Came with being a straight businessman. But Wynn was also 10 years older than Asti or Versi, not an experienced fighter or a strong runner. Asti had noticed his knee quivered a bit when he walked. It might go out on him in a sustained run. He had little business being in on a run that was hot with guards. But Asti needed a lockman with him on the bottom side of the top and bottom, mostly because he was terrible with locks. Versi on the top side was a strong enough lockman that, with the keys Wynn cut for him, he'd be able to work his way through. So it was Versi up top, Asti on bottom with Wynn. Which meant if things turned left, Asti had to make pulling Wynn out his top priority. The Pomerane was a large building, so it had several soft points of entry. Main doors, of course, were locked at this hour. One guard was in place in the entryway. This was not Pitter's position. It was going to stay manned all night. Any entry on the first floor was going to have to be mouse quiet and soft as slippers. That was not Asti's specialty. But if they were caught, putting the guard down quickly and quietly was. The back alleys around the Pomerane offered other options. There were service doors along the back and sides, but those were designed to only be opened from the inside. There was no latch, no pull, no lock. A pry bar and some muscle could probably pop those doors, but not quietly. The sun had set, and even though this part of the city had oil lamps all along the street, and a cadre of efficient lamplighters, Asti found it easy to slip into a darkened alley with Wynn. It helped that they were both dressed as respectable tradesmen. In East Maradaine, people didn't expect ruffians, and they didn't look for them. Working clothes were in Asti's satchel, along with his weapons and Wynn's keys and tools. "So the loading dock in the carriage hold," Wynn said nervously. "That's where we're going?" Asti would normally snap at the idle chatter while on a gig, but he knew this was far enough out of Wynn's comfort that he forgave it silently. They reached the gate of the carriage hold. This had no guard on duty, and from Asti's scouting the past few nights, the guards only made periodic checks throughout the evening. No reason to waste much time on it. It was a heavy barn door with a large bolt lock. A person would have to be crazy to try to break in through there, which, fortunately, Asti Rynax was. "Clever design," Wynn said as he looked at the bolt lock. "Two separate keyholes, and I think they need to be turned together. If I just had to straight crack it, it would be an hour or more, and that's just to get at the bolting mechanism." "This is the part where you should say, 'but fortunately,'" Asti said as he changed into his dark slacks and coat. "But fortunately, we have the masters I built off of Mr. Pitter's keys," Wynn said. He started inserting things into the keyholes, "and I'll need your hands in a moment." "Let me know what I can do," Asti said. He strapped on the belt of knives he wore for any gig. His father's belt, his father's knives. Damn good knives, sharp ones that kept their edge well. That was what he had left from the old man. A set of knives and a font of ill-gained wisdom on the thief trade. "All right, hands on each key," Wynn said. Asti grabbed them while Wynn pulled out a thin metal rod. He slid that into the crack of the barn doors. "On my mark, turn both together toward each other." "That's strange. Some people think stranger locks are better locks," Wynn said. "Most of the time it's just showing off. Now." Asti turned the keys and Wynn brought up his rod sharply. There was a jarring snap, far louder than Asti would have liked, but the barn door gently swung out. "Could have been worse," Asti said, while Wynn gathered up his tools. "Now we just have to get inside and slip up 5 flights of stairs without any guards seeing us." They entered into the carriage hold. "Let's shut this," Wynn said. "If anyone comes checking, they won't see anything amiss, and it's simple to open from the inside." "Great saints, Wynn," Asti said as Wynn latched the door shut. "We're going to make a disreputable man out of you." "Just as long as we get out easy," Wynn said. "No worries," Asti said, despite the many worries he was having about that very subject. "Everyone is in place."
"Everyone in place?" Bertie asked Helen.
She was now out of her washerwoman disguise, her dark black locks hanging over the purple coat and vest she favoured for gigs.
She was with him, setting up her shooting nest on the roof of the building across the street from the Pomeranian. This was not where Verci wanted to be this evening, but a top and bottom was how Asti said they had to play it, so it was what he had to do.
Far as I can see, she said, eyeing around on the scope of her crossbow. I've got Kenneth in his carriage a block away to the north, parked in front of a fancy pub. He's got Pilsen with him, playing his tipsy passenger game. That man puts on a show anyway.
Bit too much spectacle, Verci said. People are going to remember that.
They'll pay attention to that, Helen said, and thus not look up at the sky to see you leaping over the street.
I'm a no spectacle at all kind of thief, Verci said.
There's a burned down husk in Keller Cove that says differently, Helen said with a smirk. Mila's eyes on the ground right below us.
Is she selling flowers? Verci said, looking down over the edge of the roof.
Asti said that would be inconspicuous. Few actual beggars here, so she had to look like she belonged.
And Alma and Julian?
The block to the south.
The tea and fry shop with the walkway tables, Verci said. I see them. You're set?
I've got eyes. I've got clean shots if I need them, and a hand mirror to check my face painting.
Helen.
Let me joke. I know the signals. We all know the signals. You'll be fine.
All right, he said. He dug into his pack and pulled out the device he'd need. It was a good thing he decided to bring it along. Probably because, deep down, he knew that Asti would change the plan and he would have to do exactly what he was doing. He always packed for contingencies. Asti knew that. Asti knew he'd be ready for this. Sometimes he hated the way his brother thought.
Here, he said, handing the specialised crossbow to Helen. Load that and overcrank the crossbow four stops.
Overcrank a four? I didn't think the Rainmaker could handle that.
He just glared at her, and she nodded and understood. He had built her crossbow. He knew what it could handle. He also loved that she called it the Rainmaker. She always named her crossbows. He took out his own scope and checked the windows. No guard lamps visible on the sixth floor.
Aim for the stone outcropping just over the third window from the left edge. Second floor from the top.
She struggled with the crank while he clipped a few other devices to his belt, tightened the straps on his pack, and put on the bandolier of darts he had inherited from his father. With that, he was ready to go.
Damn, Helen said, rubbing her shoulder. What would happen if I shot a person with four overcranks?
Probably take their heart out of their chest, Verci said.
Or hit someone five blocks away, she said with a wicked grin.
You think you can make that shot?
I think I'd like to try.
For now, line me up, Verci said. He clipped a cord from his belt onto her bolt. Take the shot.
She rolled her eyes in the way she did when she flirted with him, which he had to admit made his heart flutter just a little bit.
You're a married man, Verci Rynax.
Without even looking through her scope, she took the shot. The bolt hit dead centre where he told her to aim, embedding into the white stone of the building.
Nice, he said, tugging on the cord.
That sprung the release in the bolt, locking it in place.
Now?
He extended a long pole and spiked it into the floor of the roof. Once it was secure, he clipped the other end of the cord to it.
Now hold that steady while I go.
She raised an eyebrow.
You know I'm not duly strong.
It'll hold fine, just keep it steady.
He sighed, climbing over the edge of the roof. It's not like I'm that heavy.
So you say?
He winked at her. She could stand a bit of heart flutter herself. And leaped over the edge, hanging from his belt. He let gravity take him down the line as he flew across the street to the window of the Pomeranian. He landed feet first on the windowsill and grabbed onto the outcropping. He glanced down to the street below. No sign from Mila. She was still down there, hawking flowers, so he must not have made any significant noise or spectacle. Making sure his grip to the side of the building was solid, he looked back over to Helen. She had eyes on him. All good. He unlatched the release on his belt so he wasn't connected to the cord anymore. Handhold strong, secure footing, safe to retract the line. With hand signals, he gave her a five count and then pressed the release on the piton bolt. It sprang out of the wall and flew back across the roof to Helen. She caught it and signaled all was well. Now if only he could get through the window without leaving any sign of tampering beyond the hole in the stone. The window was a simple double swing open, latched from the inside. Easy as anything to pop open. Probably because they would have never guessed someone would be breaking in from six stories up.
Verci slipped it open with a slim jimmy tall. Thank the saints for hot Maradaine summers, like the one they were having this year. The folks in these buildings wanted a window that they could get a breeze out of, which were a breeze to get into. Verci was mostly thrilled he didn't have to cut any glass. There was no hiding your work once you did that. The window led him into a wide hallway, not part of any one office. That was what he had hoped for. Several firms and partnerships had offices in this building, and the individual offices might be lined with jangle wires or other traps. But the hallways and stairwells had to be free to move through for the building staff to do their work. The last thing he needed was to trip the alarm of some office other than Colvar and Associates. Nothing more embarrassing than being nailed by a mark other than your target. The hallway had pull cords, which he assumed rang bells at the guard's booth on the first floor. There were also what looked like ear horns built into the wall at regular intervals, probably also echoing sound to the booth so anyone could call for help. Another time, Verci would admire the design, but right now, it just meant he had to be as silent as anything.
Oh, sweet saints, how, I've never eaten this much.
That came from behind a door at the end of the hallway, the water closet. Given that Peter was supposed to patrol this floor and the one below, that was probably him, suffering from Alma's concoction. Verci did feel some small pity for the man, but it was also clear Peter was realizing he was suffering from an unusual malady. There wasn't much time before he would report himself ill, and the hole in patrol would be filled up. Verci went for the stairwell as fast as he could without making noise, down one floor to the Colvar offices. The main lobby was surrounded by glass doors with a darkened seating area inside. Verci could barely make out the individual offices in the hallway beyond. He went for Wynne's skeleton key, trying it on the main door. It stuck a bit, but he was able to get the latch to clack open after a moment. A little too long and a little too loud for his preference, especially with the ear horns. But the door was open, and he slipped inside. Too exposed with the glass door and the open lobby. Now to find Mr. Chell's office. He was the one who worked the sale offers for the burned-out properties on Holver Alley. His name wasn't on the letter to Mendel Tyne. No one's was. But he had to be the one who knew something about it. Whoever wanted the alley burned, whoever was trying to buy out the properties, Heston Chell knew about it. Percy was of half a mind to set his office on fire. He went down the hallway, hoping no guard would come onto the floor while he was digging about. The office doors had nameplates. That helped, but the light was too dim to read it. Blast and blazes. Verci dug out the hand lamp from his pack. Clever little device he whipped up that could keep the light in a tight beam. Of course, it couldn't hold much oil and got hot as blazes before too long. Kinks to work out. He clicked his sparker and lit the lamp, double-checking through the glass door to make sure no one was out there. Still clear, for the moment. Three office doors down, he found it. Of course, it wasn't the big office at the end of the hall. That, presumably, was for Colvar, whoever he was. Verci tried the door. Locked. He then tried the skeleton key. It moved a little, but it wasn't going to cut it to get this lock. Back into his pack, he pulled out two lock tools and grease. That should be good enough. Footsteps coming down the stairwell. Verci covered up the lamp and froze. He was in the shadows. He had closed the main door. He hadn't fully latched it. If he went back to throw the latch, he would be seen through those glass doors. The steps came closer down. And then...
Oh, sweet saints, not again.
Running, pounding steps away.
Thank you, sweet saints, Verci said, getting to work on the lock.
5 minutes, he had it open. Far too long. He went into Chell's office and shut the door behind him. Quick glance about. Window on one wall. A small one, but it had a view of Helen's perch. She was still up there. Crouched low and dark. He wouldn't have spotted her if he hadn't known to look. He opened up the lamp and gave three flashes. One flash came back from her perch. That was done. No more of that. Time to start working through Chell's files with whatever time he had left. Verci had signalled he was in the office. That let Helen breathe easy, at least a little bit. She'd rather he was already back out. It was all taking too long. He should have signalled he was in by the time she counted to 200. She was almost at 400. Where were Asti and Wynne? She had seen no sign of them. Not that she'd be able to see too much from her spot. She had too many things to look for. Too much damn responsibility. She'd rather just be in a place to shoot, not have to make decisions, not have to signal if there was trouble. Somehow, those Rynax boys had the bright idea that she should be in charge of things while they were inside. A terrible idea. Follow the routine, check all the points. She swung her scope over to the right. Pilsen and Kenneth were still at their spot. Pilsen making a scene, but no trouble. And no one paying his chomey driver any mind, so they didn't notice that Kenneth was staring right at Helen's perch. Through her scope, he was almost nothing but bright white eyes, burning into her, the rest of his dark features hidden in the night. They were fine. She swung over to the left. Julie and Alma at their table. Julie had ordered cheese and bread, and was far too enamoured of eating that instead of focusing on her. That was fine. That was why Alma was with him. Alma glanced up after a moment, gave a nod. They were set, and Julian was happy with his cheese. That was about the only thing he needed to be happy sometimes. Helen envied her cousin that. Down on the road beneath her, she set her scope on Mila, working her part on the street, selling flowers. The girl was too clever for her own good. Good hands, good instincts. "Violets," Mila yelled out. "Violets of the night, violets for the departed." Violets, that was the key word. Something was wrong. Helen aimed her scope back at the building. Verci was still in the office, searching around. Through the other windows on his floor, she saw no other movement. She scanned down. Fourth floor clear. Third floor clear. Second floor. Security guards were on the move, a real active scramble. She had no eyes on Asti or Wynne, but something must have spooked the guards. They were sweeping each office, going to the stairwells. "Blazes, blazes, blazes," Helen muttered. Mirror out, she flashed a two-spot to the ground in front of Mila. Acknowledgement, that was all she could give her. Another flash to Kenneth and Alma to be at the ready. They might have to run. They might have to help Asti or Verci. She had no idea what to do. She should never be put in charge of decisions like this. Sweep the scope back to Verci. No sign of trouble on his floor, yet. But he needed to be warned. She hit his window with three flashes of her mirror. Danger. Be aware. Verci didn't notice. Blazes, blazes. Another set of flashes. Verci still didn't notice. He was digging through the office, eyes not on her. She swept her view down again. Guards were starting to sweep up to the third floor, and others were active on the fourth floor. And on the second floor, she saw Wynne in one of the windows, staring hard up at her. She signaled a flash. He returned with some hand signals that made no sense. Wynne never learned the blasted hand signals. "What? Damn it." If Wynne was alone in there, that meant Asti was in trouble, or about to start some. Wynne started pointing to his right. Helen followed along to the next window. Asti in an office, knives drawn. In the shadows, she wouldn't have spotted him if she hadn't. Blazes, she missed him before. A guard was opening the door to the room he was in. If Asti got into a fight, well, Asti would Wynne, there was no doubt, but that would skunk everything. She swung her aim to the farthest window away from Asti and fired. Glass shattered. New bolt, cranked the crossbow, loaded, fired again, shattering another window. Guards were running to those rooms. She swung her view to Asti. He locked eyes at her when she found him and nodded. Then he ran toward Wynne. Back up to Verci. He was still in the office, still searching through files. Stupid, pretty Verci. No time to be subtle. Another bolt loaded. She took aim through that window. That got Versi's attention. He snapped up to the window. She flashed him the danger signal. He signaled for her to shoot the line to him. She loaded the line bolt back into her crossbow. She struggled to overcrank it, only able to get it three cranks over. She didn't want to waste any more time, hoping it would be enough. She hitched the line to the bolt and looked through the scope to find her shot again. Office window was in her sights, but Verci wasn't in the office anymore. The place must have had some sort of silent alert trigger, some way to let the other guards know something was wrong without making a ruckus. Asti had no idea what had triggered them. He and Wynne hadn't gotten above the second floor yet, but every guard in the building was sweeping the floors, which meant 7 men total, presuming Pitter was still incapacitated. Asti could send all 7 to their graves, but that would make a blazes of a mess. They had almost been caught, and he wouldn't have had any other choice, until Helen distracted them. Thank the saints for her. He grabbed Wynne and made for the open stairwell, then changed his mind. Wynne, open up that office, Asti said, pushing Wynne to the locked door.
Why this one?
Wynne asked, fiddling the lock open. Because I need it, Asti said. He didn't have time to explain that since the job was skunked, their best course of action, in addition to getting the blazes out of the place, was to hide their target. If the guards thought someone was trying to break into the accounts office of the Falter Wood and Lumber Company, all the better. As soon as Wynne had the door open, Asti went into the office. Quick as he could, he opened up a cabinet, pulled out several papers, strewing some on the floor, and shoved a few more into his coat.
What is that?
Wynne whispered when he came back out.
No idea,
Asti said, pulling Wynne down the stairs.
Now back to the carriage hold.
Asti really wished Wynne would hush up. No, service doors. Service doors couldn't open from the outside, but were easily pushed open from the inside. Send them right back out to the alley. Out and clear. Asti stopped short before they reached the bottom of the stairs, holding Wynne back. One of the guards was latching the push bar of the service door.
That's a special key,
Wynne whispered in Asti's ear.
I don't know if I can...
Asti put a hand over Wynne's mouth. He held it just long enough for Wynne to get the message and then stepped away. The guard was still turning the latch. Asti slipped down the steps and moved up behind him. No knives. Too much mess. Asti jumped up. The guard was a half foot taller than he was and wrapped one arm around the man's neck while covering his mouth with the other hand. The man struggled and dropped back from Asti's weight. Asti kept his footing as he hit the ground. The man tried to swing a fist backward, but Asti twisted out of the way, while holding a tightening grip around the guard's neck. He then delivered a swift kick to the man's knee, forcing him down to the ground. Now able to hold his weight over the guard, he squeezed tighter while pushing his body onto the back of the man's head. The guard thrashed some more, futilely. Wynne came over and grabbed the special key out of the guard's hand and went to work opening the service door.
Go to sleep,
Asti hissed. The guard finally stopped thrashing, but Asti kept the hold for a few moments longer. He remembered a time in Druth Intelligence when he had been fooled by that trick and earned a sucker punch to the tenders in return. He wasn't about to repeat that. That and the beast in his skull didn't want him to let go. The wild animal, the broken part of his brain, howled to be let off its chain. Let it kill this guard and all the rest. Asti wasn't about to let it loose. Not over one guard, when nothing stood between him and the door. He didn't need that. Wynne didn't need that. Wynne needed to be taken out of this building. The guard slumped down and Asti dropped him. Wynne pushed the door open and Asti grabbed him by the arm and pulled him out.
This key is really...
Not now, Wynne, Asti said, dragging him along as they ran down the alley.
We're going to be seen. Not now, Wynne.
As they approached the mouth of the alley, a familiar carriage pulled up slowly in front. Familiar. Except it was mocked up like it was a Mender Company cab.
Now look here, driver, this is not the way.
Pilson Jim was in full performance of a drunken, disgruntled passenger. He was leaning out the window, a walking stick in hand, yelling at Kenneth in the driver's seat.
I know where I'm going, sir, Kenneth responded. I'm sure you do. But what you do not know is where I am going, and that is what messes.
He waved the stick around frantically. Any eyes looking that way would be locked on the stick.
Now, Wynne.
Asti dove out the alley, rolling under the carriage. Wynne did the same, but lacking the grace that Verci would have had.
Now what?
Wynne asked as they lay under the carriage.
Runners,
Asti said, grabbing the handholds and footholds Kenneth had built into the carriage. He pulled himself up so he was hidden from anyone who had happened to look under the carriage. Wynne had pulled himself up, but he struggled as he locked his elbows around the hold.
How long do we have to do this?
He grunted out.
A few minutes. I'm not that strong.
Have to wait until Kenneth moves off this street.
What's he waiting for?
Asti sighed. What Kenneth was most likely waiting for was Verci, who was probably still in the building. Chapter 3 Verci couldn't wait for Helen to send the line. shattered glass had gotten some attention.
Fifth floor, fifth floor.
At least three guards were running up the stairs. He grabbed the files he had found. He hadn't had any chance to look at them and stuffed them in his bag. He extinguished the lamp and threw it in the bag as well, slipped out of the office, shutting the door so it latched closed. Not that there was much of anywhere for him to go now. He could hear the guards in the stairwell, hands on the glass windows of the offices. They probably couldn't see him at this angle, down the hallway, but he couldn't count on them not coming in. Nowhere to go but farther in. He went for the large office of Mr. Colvar. It was farthest away from the lobby doors, out of the line of sight. Plus, there was the chance that Colvar was the type of man who had a hiding room or secret escape door. First he had heard of rich men in top offices doing things like that. If Josie Holt did it as a fence and thief boss in North Seleth, wouldn't a fancy lawyer in a big office do the same? The master key opened the door rather easily. Thanks, Saint Senia, for her small miracles. Verci went in and closed it behind him. He could probably wait out the guards in here, as they would hopefully discover the broken glass in Chell's office and move on. Two steps in, the floor panel gave when Verci put his weight on it. Suddenly, the whole office was filled with jangling bells. Stupid, stupid, stupid. Verci couldn't believe he'd missed something so obvious. He wasn't on his game, not in the slightest, and there was no chance the guards weren't coming now. Verci dashed across the room, leaped up on the desk and over to the window, tool in hand. With a quick flip of the wrist, he sprang the latch of the window and pushed it open. The guards were rushing down the hallway. He climbed out the window while rummaging through his bag for a rope and a clamp lock. It was a crude way to get out of the building, but he hardly had any other choice. Clamp latched to the window pane, he tied the rope on and let it drop down. Not quite long enough to reach the ground, but he could make do. The guards were trying to get the door open, and those damnable jangle bells were still going. First he scrambled over the edge and scurried down the rope. As he passed the fourth floor, his shoulders were already screaming at him. He hadn't done anything like this in years. Third floor, halfway there. Then all he'd have to do was run like blazes until he got to a place where he could blend in with the crowd. He hadn't heard a whistle call, so the sticks hadn't been brought in yet. He could outrun a few hired guards on open ground. Second floor. The rope shimmied. Verci looked up. One of the guards was leaning out the window, holding on to the rope. He looked quite vexed, and he turned his attention to the clamp lock. Verci wasn't worried. He had designed the clamp lock so it would be very hard for someone to release if they didn't know how it worked. There was almost no way. The rope suddenly came free, and Verci fell the rest of the way to the alley below. He tried to roll with it, but he wasn't ready. When he hit the ground, he heard a gut-wrenching crack from his leg. Running like blazes wasn't going to be much of an option. Mila kept her position on the walkway, hawking her flowers as she saw the guards running throughout the building, up and down the stairs. She watched while Kenneth moved the carriage down the street, and when she saw Asti and Wynne come out the alley, she gave Kenneth the signal of where to go. The carriage hit the mouth of the alley, and Mr. Jin made a bit of a scene so folks on the street would notice him instead of Asti and Wynne crawling under the carriage. It all went surprisingly well. She had to admit, when Asti explained the basics of the plan, she had no idea how the blazes it could work. "You'd be amazed what people don't notice," he had told her. "They're mostly in their own business. The average folk on the street won't give a damn, especially if you give them something loud and shiny to pay attention to." He was right, and Mr. Jin's performance was clearly loud and shiny. She looked back up top for Verci. She didn't spot him, but did see guards on the floor he had been on. She scanned along the length of the building. No sign of him.
"Flowers of the season,"
she called out as she quickly walked toward the other end of the building and the mouth of that alley. She hoped that Mr. Jin heard her giving the code for someone in the wind and managed to follow along.
"Flowers of the season, just half a tick," she called again.
She made it down the half a block and could see into the other alley. Verci was climbing down a rope on the outside of the building, plain as a wart on Hexie Matlin's face.
"Saint sinners and idiots," Mila muttered.
If no one on the street had noticed him, the guards up top certainly had. In an instant, they had undone the clamp lock holding Versi's rope. As Verci fell, she couldn't help but be annoyed. It had taken her an hour to figure out how to unlock Versi's clamp lock. Versi hit the ground hard, and badly.
Violets, fresh flowers of the season, and violets.
Turn the carriage around, she heard Mr. Jean call out. I think I need to buy some flowers.
Oi, he's...
Someone called out from high up. Then a grunt. Mila glanced up to see the guard leaning out the window, now slumped over. Helen must have taken care of him. Versi, in the alley, was attempting to pull himself to his feet. She wanted to run over and grab him, but she knew that she had a little too much attention on the street. Mila had to play her part, like Asti and Mr. Jin had told her. Draw focus, keep eyes off the real action.
You want some flowers, mister? She called back. You have a sweetheart to surprise?
I better make you my sweetheart,
Mr. Jin said, stumbling over to her. Mila spotted what he was trying to do, if her instincts were right. She took a few more steps over, even though it meant taking her eyes off Versi. She had to pray that Helen would keep him sighted, keep him safe. Blazes, Helen would snipe every guard in that place to keep Versi safe. Not that she'd admit it.
You've definitely got a sweet flower I'd like to get my nose in, Mr. Jin said.
Kenneth had the carriage turned around, trundling over to the other alley.
That's not what I'm selling, and you should be ashamed of yourself for that.
Who said anything about selling?
He was now in position right by the main doors of the Pomeranian.
Right, because you probably have no crowns anyway, she said.
How can you say that? I've got...
Three guards burst through the doors, the first two crashing into Mr. Jin. Mila did her bit by crying out in surprise and getting in the way of the third. He crashed into her, knocking her stock of flowers onto the street. Three guards all stumbled and fought to get back to their feet, with Mr. Jin doing his damnedest to hang on to the two of them while acting like he was just drunkenly groping.
Blazes is your problem, Mila shouted. He just crashed into...
Leave it, the third guard yelled, running around the corner. Where'd he go?
What?
Mila asked. Mr. Jin was being hauled to his feet by the other two guards.
What the blazes are you doing, old man?
There's no need for that language,
Mr. Jin said, wagging a disapproving finger at the guards.
The saints would not approve.
Saints don't approve of lechery either,
Mila snarled at him.
Who is paying for my flowers?
She punctuated that by shoving a hard finger into one of the guards' chest.
What, girl? He asked. Where's the scat?
He's gone,
the third guard said.
Whose carriage is this?
It's mine,
Mr. Jin said, dusting himself off.
A man comes through town for a bit of merriment.
Shut it, old man. Open this carriage.
What authority do you have?
Hey, chummy,
the third guard, obviously the superior here, shouted at Kenneth.
Open your carriage or we'll get the sticks to do it.
I beg your pardon,
Kenneth grumbled out. Do not presume to speak to me.
Call in the sticks, the third guard said to the other two. All of you hold until they get here.
I will do nothing of the sort,
Mr. Jin said, heading over to the carriage.
You have no authority to detain me.
You want to see if we can detain you, old man? One guard said, getting in close to Jin.
Oh, yes, let's, Jin said. Let's see you doing that when the constabulary come.
You there,
Milo yelled to a passerby.
Get to a whistle box. These men wrecked my flowers and are going to beat up an old man.
This was a blazes of a bluff. The last thing Mila wanted was for the constabulary to actually come.
We're protecting this place from... Puffed up popping jays is what you are,
Jin said.
Open up this carriage, chummy, the lead guard said, or you'll all find out what we're authorised to do.
Sticks are our friends, codger,
another whispered.
They won't mind if we bruise up an old drunk and his chummy. Which one of you is going to pay for my ruined flowers?
Mila shouted, turning to the main guard.
You smashed into me, trampled my goods, and I demand you pay me 35 crowns for the lot.
35 crowns?
He shoved Mila right in her face, pushing her to the ground.
Ober, open up the damn carriage. If the chummy gives you trouble, crack his right in skull.
Whistle calls now pierced the air. Wouldn't be long for the sticks, not in this neighbourhood. Ober pushed Mr. Jin to his partner and swaggered over to the carriage. He hesitated a moment at Kenneth's glare, but still grabbed hold of the carriage door and opened it. No one inside.
Look under, the leader said.
Mila saw a constabulary horse patrol riding up the street. She decided this was a fine moment to use the best weapon in her arsenal right now. Tears. She let out a horrific wail.
Nothing under the carriage, boss,
Ober said.
Shut her the blazes up,
the boss said. He went over to the horse patrol. Evening, officers.
What's the situation?
The constable asked, getting off his horse.
We had a break in here, the boss said, pointing to the building.
These two interfered with our attempt to apprehend the thief.
What thief?
Jin asked. I was just trying to court this pretty girl when these lunks came barreling into me.
And trampled my flowers.
Mila forced out through her fake sobs.
They ruined me.
And broke into my carriage.
Kenneth added.
Violated my rights, officer.
Well, everyone just calm down, the constable said. Where's this thief? He was in the alley, but he's gone. The constable said, looking down the alleyway. Nowhere to go but out here, it seems. Yet he got away, you say? He must have, the boss said. The constable looked into the open carriage, but he didn't go in there. He glanced up at Kenneth. This was open when I arrived. It's no violation for me to look inside.
I know my rights, Kenneth growled.
You're going to have the right to be pinked up in a cell at the station house if you don't trap your mouth, son, the officer said.
Who is going to pay for my flowers?
Mila shouted, hoping the officer would pay more attention to her and less to the carriage.
That isn't my problem, little girl, the officer said.
He glared at the three guards. Why don't you get back in there, where your authority begins and ends? I'm sure you've got some mess to handle.
Officer, Mr. Jin said, pulling himself away from the guards. If you have no objection, I'd just like to get in my carriage and head home.
The officer said. And where is home?
Over on Enterfield, Jin said.
North Colton, the officer said with a nod. I don't suppose you have any identification on you.
Jin dug through his pockets, pulling out some papers and loose goldsmith bills.
There you are, officer, Mr. Davian Alan.
Says so, right there.
The officer glanced at the papers, grunting.
This is how we're going to settle all this, then. You three get back in your building. The guards still hadn't moved. If you failed your job and a thief got away, it's not your problem anymore. One of you wants to come to the station house to make a statement, that's just fine. Constabulary will search out your thief. He did not sound like they would actually put much effort into it. You, Cider Breath, are going to give this 20-crown note to the flower girl.
Why would I?
Because I said so. And someone should pay for her stock, and you're the one with crowns falling out of your pocket.
He took the note from Mr. Jin's papers and handed the rest back to him.
But, and you, girl, are going to take this 20 crowns and get the blazes out of my sight.
He threw the money on the ground at her.
My stock was worth...
Mr. Jin was continuing to argue with the constable, so she trusted his judgment and took her cue from him.
You're going to be glad with 20 crowns and that's that. All of you, get the blazes out of here.
He took out his hand stick and pointed it at Kenneth, especially you. Maybe you shouldn't take jobs in this part of town,
Fine, fine, Jin said, getting in the carriage. It's been a sour night anyway. Take us home, driver.
Kenneth made a noise and snapped his reins, and the carriage started rolling away.
Girl, the constable said, his attention now on her. Take your money and get out.
Mila snatched up the note and made some show of salvaging her tray of flowers, giving the officer one last glare before stalking off. A block away, Helen came out of an alley and started walking with her.
That was harrowing, Helen said. How long did you watch?
Mila asked as they strolled at a quickened pace.
Until the stick sent the carriage away, Verci made it in. Asti had to carry him, but yes, she said. That was far too close. Let's get back home to the safe house, Mila said. I'm done with this neighbourhood.
The secret compartment under the seats of the carriage had been designed for one person to hide comfortably, or for two people to squeeze in if they had to. For three people to be crammed in there was excruciating, at least for Asti, especially since the beast in his skull was still whispering to him. It wasn't howling to be let loose anymore, but it whispered.
You failed, Verci.
Verci was curled up in the compartment, his elbow jammed into Asti's ribs, while Asti also had Wynne's knees in his back. Neither one of these things made quelling the beast any easier, especially with Asti's head pressed against the wall of the compartment.
He could have saved him.
Asti hadn't got much of a chance to look at Verci's leg, but it looked horrible as they loaded him into the carriage. Asti was pleasantly surprised at how well Verci was bearing the pain he must be in, especially crammed in this tiny space. Even if he wasn't making any noise, Asti could feel the cold, clammy sweat on his brother's brow.
This is your fault.
Pilsen gave a series of knocks, indicating they were in the clear. Asti undid the latches and the secret compartments sprang open. He, Verci, and Wynne all tumbled out into the back of the carriage.
"Well, this has been thrilling," Pilsen said. "You're all lucky that Kenneth and Mila have sharp eyes."
"Oh,"
Verci said loudly.
"Oh, sweet saints, oh."
Pilsen looked down.
"Great saints, son. You aren't supposed to bend your foot in that direction."
"How bad is it?"
Verci asked. His face was horribly pale, Poasian pale, and his curly mop of dark hair was soaked in sweat. Asti looked down at his brother's leg. There was no doubt it was broken. The foot was twisted at an unnatural angle. Now he truly was amazed Verci wasn't screaming. He certainly would have been.
"Wynne, help me get him up on the seat. I can barely move my..."
"Now, Wynne." Wynne scrambled up and helped lift Verci up onto the carriage seat. Once Verci was in position, Asti half climbed out the window to see Kenneth. "What's our time to the safe house?"
"Just a few minutes," Kenneth said. "We're already in Seleth and the streets are clear.
Don't spare the whip, hmm?
Should I go to Kimber's, find Doc Gelson?"
Asti considered that for a moment. Verci probably would need the old drunk, that was certain, but they also needed to get whatever Verci found back to the safe house.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.